From New York and on the new Hot 97 app, Ebro in the Morning on Hot 97.
In the studio right now, Brooklyn native.
Brooklyn native.
Trinidad. Tobago.
Pong, 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 pong.
His name is Winston. Don't give it up for him.
Winston. Winston.
And I definitely got to shout out Tobago most of all because they get on me if I don't say Tobago.
Oh, right. Hell yeah. Absolutely.
What part of Trinidad?
I'm from Tobago, but you know,
Sean,
one
you just
country
said it. You still just said Tobago.
Tobago.
Yeah, but I mean, I didn't know that meant he was from Tobago.
Yeah,
there's not a lot of
There's a little saying. If people say I'm from Trinidad, they're from Trinidad. If they say I'm from Trinidad and Tobago,
they're from Tobago. That's a great point. That's a great point.
All right, so Winston, you grew up here in New York City.
Yes, I grew up in Brooklyn, near Flatbush, between New York and Nostrand.
I saw the movie. Laura saw the movie. Shani saw the movie. Rosenberg has not.
I'm seeing it Saturday night, 8 o'clock.
Did you expect this thing to be a, like when you first got asked to be in the film, did you know what you were getting into?
Well, I knew there would be a lot of cultural significance around the movie, but there's the movie and then there's the event around it. And that's the thing that you can't ever plan. We didn't know, at least I didn't. And the other thing is, this is my first film altogether.
Wow.
Period.
Yeah, period. This is my first, this is my film debut.
Yo, that mind blown. Rosenberg, and I can't even tell you, I tried to explain to you who this guy was in the film, right? I can't tell you the role he's got is the thing that makes this film different than a lot of other Marvel films. Okay. He's a Marvel guy. Mm-hmm. He plays a role that the way they use him in the movie, there's obviously the standard, but you do some things that I don't want to give away that.
But I could give a little synopsis of around the character. So.
Well, yeah, no, but we'll get to that. But the comedy, let me just say that. Yeah. There's funny that he provides. There's a traditional period in most Marvel films, about an hour and 15, hour and 10 into it, where there's a setup for the close. Mm-hmm. And there's this crossroads people are at and these things are happening. And usually there's a long, drawn-out monologue, and it kind of gets long-winded.
Yeah. Yeah.
His character makes that different than any Marvel film I think I've seen. I haven't seen that happen before. And that's amazing. Like, you're a standout because of that.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
So what's your description? Because you obviously
used to talk about it. You know, like, the basic setup is that M'Baku is the leader of one of the main tribes of Wakanda. So they exist a bit outside of Wakanda. They don't exist as Wakanda proper. They pray to a whole different god. They pray to the gorilla god Hanuman, while the rest of Wakanda prays to the panther goddess Bast. Right. So they exist a little bit outside of the mainstream culture, and they're traditionalists. So they believe that the best way for the country to move forward culturally and socially, economically, politically is through like this clear adherence to their past. So they dress more traditional, like they dressed in like these thatched skirts, and they, you know,
they're mountain men too.
Yeah, they're mountain men.
They have
mountain women.
Black
and,
people in the mountains.
Got it.
It's a real thing.
Black people in the cold. It's cold up there.
Yeah.
So they just exist differently, and they don't believe in that whole the importance of vibranium for just like running the country and basing the economy and all the policies and politics around. So he's like the leader of an entire community and people and tribes. So he has a lot of responsibilities.
Okay. It also too, there's one thing that's amazing is that they create an atmosphere in the film where there's obviously dissension amongst tribes and there's tribal things that happen, et cetera,
et cetera. Yeah, it's deeply political. Yeah,
but it's
politics.
Also very, in some ways, unified, which I thought was, did you, I guess the underlying theme of unity and these other things with, you know, addressing just the overarching cultural aspects.
Yeah.
Going into doing the film, did you know Coogler was going to take it that deep?
No, I mean, Marvel keeps everything really close to the chest. So we didn't get to see a script, at least I didn't get to see a script. Because I can't tell you how everybody else's situation is set up. But I didn't see a script until probably the week of or like 2 weeks before we did a pre-testing and all that stuff and did like a table read and all this stuff. So I like probably booked the job, say, in late August and then didn't see a script until November.
Like, were there times in there when it became like hard to believe that this was actually happening?
The whole way through. Like, I was like, you know, because this is my first film, and I could only be happy. I could just be happy to be in a film with Lupita or you know, one of these juggernauts, you know what I mean? And then you're in a movie with Forrest Whitaker, you know, Angela Bassett, Lupita Nyong'o, Chadwick Boseman, the list just kept going.
Not only in the movie, you're in scenes.
I'm in the movie.
I know. Yeah.
Like, you're in scenes with Angela Bassett, son.
But being that this is your breakout, this is your first film, tell us a little bit about, you know, your background and how you got there. Because for a young actor, for this to be your first breakout film is insane.
Yeah, I mean, it's been, you know, I wouldn't just say it's been a charmed experience because it's been hard along the way as well. But, you know, I come from the Caribbean, so moved here with my family.
Pong, pong.
Tobago, Shani. Tobago.
Tobago. Tobago. Tobago.
Tobago. Tobago.
So moved here with my family, my sister and mother. You know, was raised by a single mother. And my sister wanted to be a doctor in the Caribbean. And my mother said, hey, this is possible, but it's not possible here. So she sold everything that we owned and moved here, you know, to Brooklyn. We got, you know, a little one bedroom, not even a one bedroom, what do you call it?
Studio.
Studio apartment. And, you know, my sister went to school, then I went to, once she got into medical school, I went to live with her. After high school, I went to University of Buffalo, and then I took a year off just like living, and I lived in Baltimore for a year, just like doing stuff. And then I went to Yale School of Drama where I met Lupita Nyong'o. Wow. And, you know, was in a club created by Angela Bassett, actually, and graduated in 2013 and just been working professionally ever since, doing theater, doing television, and now finally a film role.
Well, while we have you here, I think it's only right since you're from Trinidad and Tobago. I want you to take this moment while all of New York City, your home, is listening. Yeah. And I'm sure people in Trinidad might be streaming right now.
Yeah.
You got to pick a tune.
Hey.
You got to pick a tune for the people. Like,
any tune?
Because you're in, yo, Trinidad and Tobago's in Black Panther.
Facts.
Really?
This is a big deal.
See?
It's a big deal.
When Shani saw him, this is how this happened. We saw him on TV yesterday on Fox. Shout out to Fox, who plays in the studio here. Yeah. And so we see you talking, and Shani goes, he's African. He hears your accent. He goes, he's African. I was like, how you know? Then as soon as you said that, you're like, I'm from Trinidad and Tobago. He's like, he's Trini. He's Trini.
That's my people.
I was like, yo, Shani, you didn't even know his accent. People. You didn't
look,
even know.
I only heard like three lines, three words. And I was like, oh, he actually is. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I thought maybe you were American and putting on an accent. Because everybody in the movie had to put on an accent.
Yeah.
I know
Angela
Bassett doesn't have an accent, but she put one on too.
But I mean, like, everybody's still like part of the diaspora. You know what I mean? Like, Daniel Kaluuya is from Uganda.
Yeah.
His family's from Uganda. Lupita's family from Kenya. You know, Danai, you know, I can't remember what country she's from, but it's part of the continent. Everybody kind of spans, and we all are, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, we all are part of the continent, you know what I mean? So we all have that similarity and, like, that, like, diasporic vibe. So, yeah, it was a cool thing, man.
So, tune, you got a tune, soak a tune.
You got any bungee? I would settle for any bungee.
Oh, bungee. Yeah.
You ready for the road? You ready?
Differentology, we got to have that.
Let's go. Winston Duke on the show, representing Trinidad and Tobago. Good vibes right there with the bungee. Shout out to Bungee, wherever you are. You might be in New York City. Listen, this says here you're going to be in Infinity War 2.
Yep.
Now, I know a lot of people, that trailer's out.
You heard that answer. That's what I could say.
Yes, I'm in it. And now is the whole Jabari tribe in Infinity War. Can you at least tell us that?
I can't tell you that. I could just tell you that it's going to be an incredibly epic, fun, large-scale film. Infinity War is like nothing you've ever seen. So Wakanda sets up a brand new world. Wakanda sets up like all this beautiful new stuff for you to take
in. And it also ties the vibranium story together, right? For Captain America's shield, which I think is not really giving too much away.
Definitely. And a lot of people know that Bucky is in, you know, Wakanda. So we'll get to see different things that way too.
Yeah, it's dope.
Yeah,
did you know, I guess they didn't show you, but did you know the Black Panther story? Were you a comic book head before?
Deeply a comic book head before. So I didn't know a lot about the Black Panther story because he still wasn't as mainstream as, say, like the mutants or like Spider-Man or something like that. But I knew it because I watched a lot of cartoons as well, and he's been had a big resurgence in the last like probably 8 years in a lot of the cartoon and media coming out of Marvel. So I was experienced with that, and I was familiar with M'Baku, but they were calling him Manape this whole time as well. Yeah.
I prefer the new
M'Baku.
Name.
You like M'Baku?
I'm gonna go with M'Baku better.
Manape is. Probably you want to stay away from that.
Yeah.
It's not even a character I can talk about.
But yeah, I knew him as Manape before, so I always knew his function in the film, in the narrative. So once I got, because I didn't even get real sides for the audition. Mm. The audition was like Ryan Coogler just wrote what we call dummy sides. And you just go in and audition with that. You sign an NDA, you can't say anything. Mm. But once I kind of felt like the break of the scene, I was like, okay, this has to be M'Baku.
Yeah.
Okay. And they didn't even tell me what film I was auditioning for either.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. It was just untitled Marvel project.
Mm.
And then I read the thing. Wow. I was like, this royalty, this seems kind of royal. Like the tone of the scene is like pretty crazy and it's like big and grand. And I was like, okay, I think this might be Black Panther. And then when I kept going through and like filling out the character, I was like, this feels like M'Baku. This is crazy. Okay, let's do this. And I went in there and I've seen all these like huge celebrities, everybody in the room to audition. I was like, shit, I don't think I'm gonna get this. I don't know if I'm here, but all right, let's go into this room. And I remember just like right before me, there was this dude doing his audition. And it wasn't even close to the room. It was a little bit down the hall. And he was just like screaming. I was like, okay, I'm not going to do that. You know what I mean? Like just going to go in there and be in the room. And I went in and it was just a really cool, supportive situation. And the rest is history, you know?
How would you, Winston, prepare people who haven't seen the film for, you know, I've said it on the air. Look, I'm excited that there's a film that literally is being taken so seriously insensitive that literally critics aren't even saying anything negative. Like nobody wants, like black folks is like, yo, nah, y'all can't say nothing.
Yeah.
I went into the film, they make fun of me. I went into the film looking for like to be a cynic. Not because of the cultural aspects, but on some like Marvel, like the fight scenes are probably whack, but I'ma love what it represents.
Yeah.
Or maybe the special effects like ain't where some other films are, but you know, boom, boom, boom. Man, it hit every mark.
Yeah.
Every mark. And if you're a Marvel fan, it hits every mark. And then if you're culturally into it to just see black people, unlike you've never seen black film on the screen before and just regal, just larger than life, you know, no slavery convo, no like all of that. It's just, it's a whole other place.
Yeah, it's not a narrative that's wrapped in like, it's not driven by black pain.
No.
The black people in the film are the creators. They're the inventors. They're running the country. You know what I mean? They have a lot of agency. They have a lot of power in their lives, and that's actually pretty incredible and beautiful to see. The woman...
And would you say that the film doesn't even... I tried to explain to the audience, it's not even so much about like...
Mm.
Blackness, but it is. Like, you don't even have to say it in the film. Is that making sense what
well,
I'm saying?
Well, it doesn't really rely on
race, per se.
It doesn't rely on race, but it doesn't shy away from it.
True.
And, you know what I mean? Like, the difference between this film, because this isn't the first black Marvel superhero. We had Blade, we had Storm, we had all
these
people.
Luke Cage, TV show.
Luke Cage and all these things. But sometimes it feels like with superhero narratives, the superhero just happens to be black. You know what I mean? Like, it could have been a white guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Blade, but sometimes could have been a white guy. He's a vampire. He's like, you know what I mean? But T'Challa is an African king. Yes. You know what I mean? Like, these people are black.
Yeah.
And it's not a mistake or by happenstance that they're black. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. With all this power and agency in the film. They are black. They know it. They celebrate it. And they're, you know, they have power in their lives. And power in the world. It's a narrative where, you know, the black people have the power to like even the playing field. You know what I mean? Like they have the power, the technology, the weaponry, the this, that
The world wants.
The world wants. You know what I mean? They have that resource. So that's something that's incredibly powerful. And I don't know if I need to prepare people for it. I think people have been asking and yearning for that. Like, the whole movement of, like, Afrofuturism. You see that all the time in Afropunk. In New York. That vibe, everybody's asking for it. And we've been creating that world forever.
Well, and right now, more than ever, right, feels like the time in which people want to live in this world. Because the world in which we're facing every day is so awful.
Yes, and I mean...
And archaic.
Archaic, and, you know, we live in a weird political culture right now. And everyone's just like, I don't know what the future's going to look like. I don't know if this is a safe space for me and my blackness or my coloredness. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if this is a safe space for my politics. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And this film says, here's an imaginative world where all that can exist and thrive and be beautiful and be strong. So... I don't know if I need to prepare people. I think in the back of a lot of people's
heads,
you
to say what
it's
you
already
said.
Dead.
That's the preparation I wanted. Like, them to understand what the film...
Yes. So it's just,
movie.
It's a lot.
What's the difference between movie and film?
It's the same thing. It's just a fancy way, probably.
It's just you only refer to this movie as a film.
That's right, because it's important.
Yeah. Right. it's just the gravitas you're putting into it.
Yeah. So, you know, it's something special. It's definitely something special. And like you were saying, everybody right now, we're in this landscape and a continued landscape of everybody asking for, like, inclusion. Everybody's asking for, representation.
Demanding,
crying out for it, screaming, marching. And, you know, they're saying that my story is valid. And this story, especially, we can't wait for it to be in the theaters. We can't wait for people to start actually going and spending money on it. Because
I'm so anxious. It's tough for me to interview you right now because there's a lot of conversations I want to have because I've seen it.
Yeah.
Don't want to spoil it. Yeah. And hopefully we get to, you know, circle back around at a later date. Will you be participating in the conversations that definitely will happen after people start seeing this film?
Around the
cultural... relationships of black people in the world, in the diaspora.
I think I'm already in those conversations.
Are you gonna, like, is there gonna be like panel discussions and tour? Like, how is it, how do you see this playing out? Outside of Marvel, just as you as a black man that was in this film.
Of course, I'm always having these, I was having these conversations before this film. And this film just allowed me the opportunity to be part of something that makes it more poignant, you know what I mean, and taps me into the conversation in a not a meaningful way, but a present way, because I have something that I'm attached to, you know, a reason to be there.
Right.
But I've been part of this conversation, so I'm happy to have them.
And have you been to Africa before?
Yeah, I've been to Tanzania. So in 2011, I went there as part of this school project. We went to Dar es Salaam and we went into some communities and found out what the problems that were existing, and we created theatrical art pieces that reflected that and performed them live in the streets. And then when a lot of people, 200-300 people gathered around to watch our show, at the end of it, we'd engage them in conversations like, hey, did we get it right? Is this really what's here? And they'd say, yes, it's here, or no, that's not really the thing. What the thing is this. And then the trick about it, not trick, but the special thing about it that we did as well was invite like a community organizer with us. So when they were saying, yeah, this is the problem, this and this, the community organizer would say, well, we've been trying to get people to rally around this cause for a while, and we have a petition, we have a this. So how about you guys sign and do this stuff?
Right, really community.
Yeah.
And does the political climate there support, you know, do the politicians? Because you hear on this side is the corruption of politics and, you know, Africa not being able to sustain itself, which we know is not quite the case.
It's not quite the case.
Right, but there is some corruption that takes place, like in a lot of governments around
corruption
the world.
Corruption is international, so, you know.
Do you think that many of these countries in the continent have what it takes to fix themselves and deal with the issues that are present day?
I think they do, but the problems that exist in Africa aren't an African problem. Mm. You know what I mean? Like, the problems that exist in Africa and South America and the Caribbean and a lot of places where, you know, it's predominantly people of color isn't their problem. It's affected by a larger geopolitical issue. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So
something that has happened to them.
Something that's happened to them and things that continue to happen to them. You know what I mean? Like exploitation isn't something that is of the past. It's a present. Continuing thing. It's in present. The present. So it's not just them. So it's not, hey, you got to fix yourself or pull yourself up by the bootstraps. It's like, that's a larger conversation. Yeah.
For the people who are just seeing trailers, they're Marvel fans. How would you kind of get everybody's brain wrapped around how deep this film is? Culturally significant, you know, without giving away too much. Because that's a tough conversation, right? Like, the conversation I'm waiting for everyone to see because there's so many things I want to talk about culturally.
Well, you know, and we could just, like, take a step in it. It's like this film is going to mean a lot because it sets up a world where you see Black people and people of color with a lot of strength and agency in their life. You see Black people who are the leaders of a country, Black people who are, you know, the inventors and creators of technology, Black people running their own narrative. And it's not in proximity in a lot of ways to whiteness. So it's incredibly beautiful. It's incredibly powerful. It's important for kids. You know, that's one of the things that really moves me the most is that kids are going to get to consume material like this before the world tells them who they are, before they get all those isms placed on them and politics around their bodies that tell them, you know, what they can and can't be. They get to see a film like this with people who look like them and not just people that they're told to like love or respect or be beautiful. Like, you know, it's people who look like their uncles, their aunts, their mothers, you know what I mean? People who look exactly like me, and they can see that and go, okay, my narratives are worthy of investment.
Yeah.
My narratives are worthy of, you know, celebration. My narratives are worthy to be distributed and disseminated internationally, and that's beautiful. So they're gonna grow up not thinking that it's something new. They're not gonna have to go through another this first African superhero.
And also the idea of when kids grew up forever, when little Black kids grew up, they go see the action movie. And they'd be like, that's so cool. I love the action movie.
Yeah.
And it's like, but to find images of themselves, you'd have to show them this historical Black film where Black people are portrayed in a light that's kind of sad. Yeah. And they'd be like,
kind of.
Yeah, incredibly sad.
Not
to say there weren't heroic characters, but those heroic characters aren't characters that little kids aspire to.
Exactly.
Little kids aspire to be like Spider-Man, you know, or Black Panther.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now I think there's like something you can't even qualify how much that will impact the brains of little kids.
Yeah, and I mean, like, even
though my 3-year-old wants to see it, I don't even know if she's that kid. She's like, Dad, can I see Black Panther? I don't even know where she got that from.
It's everywhere. But it's just like the kind of options that adults could kind of share with kids. And that's the other thing that you're seeing with Black Panther is not only are people committing and saying that they're going to see it once, twice, three times, they're also gifting the film. They're gifting the film to different communities, gifting the film to schools, to like after school programs, to their family, their friends. So it's a really cool thing. And it's a really cool choice for adults to share with kids, because I remember growing up in Brooklyn, sometimes the teachers had all the right ideas about what they wanted to do with us, you know what I mean? And so they would show us movies like, you know, like all these gangster films and things like that to try to warn us about gang culture and this or that. But they're using racist stereotypes and racist tropes to teach us about ourselves and our community when that kind of served to just scare us against people who looked like us.
Right.
That just scared me against my own community because I was like, I was new to the city. I was new to New York. I was new to America. So the only, a lot of the times, even at school where they're teaching me about America and Blackness was to scare me. You know what I mean? So
I don't think a lot of people realize the impact of that when they're doing it.
So,
or they do realize, you know, my more sinister mind, they do realize the impact, and that's a part of the thing that continues to tear the community up.
Yeah, of course. And it's coming from an earnest place. So they mean well, but sometimes, you know, a really powerful thing for me is just always to remember that intention doesn't always equal impact. So their intentions were in the right place, but the impact that they were having on me was totally not cool. And then for to be in a film like this where I can go, okay, adults are going to have the opportunity to show kids a narrative where, hey, you can impact your life positively or negatively, but you have that choice in your life, that agency. And you'll see that with the characters in the film. You'll see that with T'Challa, and you'll see that with Killmonger. You can make a choice to be positive or negative in your life, but you can actually control your life. It's your destiny is up to you. You can be the leader of a country. You can be an inventor. You can be like Shuri. You know what I mean? Like, all the black people in the film have agency. You know what I mean? The black women love themselves.
It was incredible. What I mean?
And the black men love them and are scared of them at the same damn time. Which
like
is
real
facts.
Life.
Which
that's
is
like
real
facts.
Life. Which
facts.
Is real life. When did you see the film? You've seen it at the red carpet?
Yeah,
in LA?
So the first time we saw the film, all of us, except for, I don't know, maybe Chadwick, but, you know, he's the star of the film. But the rest of us saw the film for the first time during the red carpet. And that's the first time we're seeing it fully with all the CGI,
the music,
and seeing it with the music, and seeing what all the other scenes that you're not in looks like. You know what I mean? Because we only did a table read once, and that was the only time we actually got to have a full sense of
wow.
all the voices and what everyone, you know, choices that they could make, because everything changes on the day when it's up on its feet.
Mm. And then you're just working on your own, and people
yeah.
forget, like, you're not seeing that as it's
yeah.
getting done. You're,
yeah.
You know what
yeah.
it's supposed to
yeah.
be, but you
yeah.
haven't seen it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So how pleased were you? Like, was it literally the best case scenario?
It was the best case scenario. It was amazing, and the reactions in the room, I heard a woman behind me just going, yes, Jesus, 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 Jesus. And I was like, okay, it's it.
Yeah,
yo. You know what I mean? Daniel Kaluuya sitting behind me every time I get up there. He's like slapping me. I was like, that's you, that's you, that's you, that's you. And like every time he gets up there, I'm like, yes, yes, yes. So like, you know, the support in the room was crazy. And then the love that everyone was there showing was amazing, you know. Monet was in the house. Usher was in the house. Ta-Nehisi Coates was in the house. You
wow,
know what
yeah.
I mean? So, like, the full spectrum of, you know, art and culture curators were in the house supporting us.
Yeah.
And it felt really beautiful.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Man.
And then that sense of community was also there while we were, shooting as well. Janelle Monáe, had us over to her house, and, you know.
Dance party, let's get
this
it.
This is a party, and yeah. just, like, chill, though. But, you know, like, Martin Freeman from The Hobbit is over there. He's, like, on the drums, like, chilling, kicking it. Everybody's, like, just having fun. And it was, like, the kind of support was beautiful because it kind of just felt really communal, and they knew what we were doing, and they knew what we were making. So, like, that gave us some sense of what the reception could have been. You know what I mean?
And how
because
amazing is
the community was reaching out and helping.
To think that you're only 4 or 5 years removed from being at Yale
yeah.
studying, right? And the opportunity that you have to think about the generations of black actors before you who all they could dream of playing were roles.
Janitors.
Yeah, were just terrible
servants.
Roles. That's all
yeah.
they could. And you're 4 years in, you're a kid, you're brand new to this.
Yeah.
You're starting.
Yeah.
It's. I mean, listen, you're kind of the first generation maybe of actors that could have this experience.
Yeah, I was talking
yeah.
earlier, look, Coogler's what, 31?
31,
yeah. 32.
Michael B. Jordan, 31, mm-hmm. 32.
Lupita's like 34.
Yeah.
I'm somewhere around there.
I respect it. But
I still play 17 on TV. So it's all good.
No, but it's dope. We're watching the beginnings of literally a new faces
brand
of Hollywood
new.
And
of
a
course,
brand new movement.
Of course,
in real time, which is
well,
amazing.
You know, I feel like the fight before was to be seen. The fight before was to be recognized and have more opportunities. And I think what's really changing in the culture, the entire entertainment industry is a culture of ownership. So not only can we be seen, we want to own how we're represented. We want to own our narratives. We want to create our narratives. Because before, everyone was just creating it for us. And we had to kind of fill the roles and bring the integrity and be like, you know, we don't really speak like that. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, we don't do that. We don't do this. So now it's like we're creating it. So
Black and you're Panther. Creating with people who understand culturally who you are and what is trying to be accomplished and what's real and what's
because
fake.
Because if you think about it, Black Panther was created by Stan Lee and Jack Kirby, two white men, you know, in the 60s.
1966.
Yeah. And now this movie in 2018 is being helmed by Ryan Coogler. Is being, you know, executive produced by Nate Moore, another black man.
Didn't know that.
You know what I mean? And, you know, he's opening doors. Like, he's been on this project for years and was the one being like, you know, who can we bring into the Avengers?
Didn't Black Panther. Had no idea,
you know what I mean?
That there was another black man behind
exactly.
the scenes at Marvel
so
doing this.
Yeah, who works for Marvel itself. And he's pushing the narrative and pushing it himself. So
this is a home run all the way around.
All the way around. And it's like things like that we have to take notice of. Because the conversation that we're in now is one for ownership. And we, you know, we don't have full ownership of the story, but we have more onus and investment in it in now, a different way.
How do you feel about this over the last few days, I guess, there's been this... petition going on, lobbying to get Marvel and Disney to give 25% of the proceeds to be reinvested into the community, sort of a petition that some people are jumping onto. Do you think there's an obligation there for the company to do that? Something you'd like to see, or is it not something that's crossed your mind?
I wasn't too familiar with that story before, but, you know, it's the black community are the ones, and, you know, people of color are the ones who are going to be supporting this movie, so if... they can give back, it would be, of course, it would be a great thing.
Yeah, you know me, I'm signing a petition, stick them up. Let's get it. I don't feel like Marvel's obligated at all, because it's a movie company. Yeah.
But
it would
be
mean,
great.
I mean, in an ideal scenario,
yeah, would be great to give
would
back.
A corporate entity want to go, hey, you know what, this community is underserved, and this movie is about that relationship. You know what, let's give to some community organizations.
Of course.
My one piece of advice might have been like, let's start the number not at 25% of total gross profit.
And maybe go in high,
maybe
you end up
somewhere else.
Maybe you end up somewhere else, man. Listen, man, it was great talking to you. Winston Duke, ladies and gentlemen, representing Trinidad and Tobago, Black Panther film.
Every time.
Shawnee, you got any questions?
Every time. Nah, man, I want to see the movie again.
Hey.
I
want to
see the movie again.
Hey.
Who came with the...
That's a spoiler. That's a spoiler.
Can't say it. You just ruined the whole movie.
Hey, y'all, give it up one time, Winston.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for having me.